we need to take notes. So they have their own PowerPoint presentation written by their own hand at the end of the lecture. Because you can write completely different things, and you probably would like to draw and make arrows and you know, networks of ideas, etc. So it's up to you how to put my ideas in a different form and then ask your questions. So I develop your ideas through your own interventions, questions, comments, etc. Zygmunt Bauman, who is a sociologist, maybe some of you have read his work. I have been supervising a series of books to be translated into Arabic, his series of books on modernity. And he used in many books the title liquidity. So liquid modernity, liquid life, liquid love, liquid times, liquid fear, and liquid surveillance. So this is actually what our age is about. It's about liquidity. And earlier in 1991, he wrote a book, which is actually a very interesting book, and he put his hands on the sort of postmodern times we are living in, or if you want to call them late capitalist or late modernity, or whatever, as Friedrich Grimm and other critics have called them. And he said it's all about getting out of that binary thinking between the chaos and order. So anything that is out of the system is seen as chaotic and is seen as taking the human action and the human individual and collective agency towards disorder. And this was actually the obsession of modernity, to put things in order. We had this since the beginning of philosophy, the same concern, how to make sense of the cosmos, starting from the very early different philosophies in different civilizations. But the obsession with the orderly understanding of the world based on an understanding of a system is actually, has developed by the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, and we're still seeing this manifestation. The Enlightenment project wanted to grasp what is going on, and not only grasp it, but control it. So this obsession with order and control, order and the ability to manage and to have a say about what's going on, vis-a-vis what was assumed of the religious sort of paradigm or the religious worldview, that there is a God and we don't have every tool in our hand and we should be submissive to fate and to whatever we can't expect, the whole idea of the unexpected. So, uncertainty was supposed to be something that modernity would overcome by control of the human mind, by setting the methodologies for understanding the material, visible world that we have, by developing the tools, by changing the economy, by building cities in a way that would facilitate the capitalist transactions, by developing science to be the tool and the vehicle for this control, and to put the what we call the ghaib, to put the transcendental in the box of specificity or in the box of privacy. So, but the promise was not fulfilled. And as Bauman in his book Ambivalence and Modernity mentions, he says that we have to get out of this binary understanding of the world being located between chaos and order. The same concern is actually behind what is now developing for those who come from different backgrounds in social sciences and are a bit aware of the developments in computing, in what is called the fuzzy theory, or theories of complexity, or theories of chaos, which is not chaotic as we assume it is. You know, chaos is not about that the world is turning into pieces or dismantling, but the chaos means that there are emerging new patterns that we do not know yet, so we have to explore them and see how they unfold, basically. And sometimes by the time when you decipher and by the time you decode the new pattern, a new pattern emerges, so it's an unfolding process. It reminds me actually when we read in the Quran, وَالسَّمَاءُ خَلَقْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. This sense of al-ittisa', as-sa', that it is expanding in a way God used this term in the Quran, and this is what we call in social sciences unfolding of the human phenomena, but also it can be unfolding of the natural phenomena as well. So this unfolding means that we have to develop our tools of understanding, and that we have to understand that between the zero and the one in computing, and between the chaos and the disorder that we assume in the social sciences and understanding human life and social life, there are so many degrees of melange, a mixture between both. Different potentials, different opportunities, different forms, what is called in Arabic صيغ متنوعة ومختلفة لما يمكن أن يكون عليه الحال. So this we find very much embedded since the beginning in fiqh, interestingly. And here I want to actually bring some of the attention to what Ziauddin Sardar has written quite early in his writings. For those who know him, he is a Pakistani British writer and futurist and analyst and prolific speaker. He wrote that Sharia is actually in its more abstract form, and the way fiqh developed, it's a problem solving methodology. It's not about do and don't do, you know, because between do and don't do, there are so many different things to be done. Like, for example, not being able to do something and striving to be able and to attain the potential of doing it, to be empowered, to get the ability, to which extent you can or you can't do something, or to abstain from doing something, or al-mubah, that you can do or not do depending on your will, and it is available in the options for the believer, depending on your piety and on your understanding of where the action would lead to. And then if you deem it to be harmful at the end, when it unfolds, then don't do it based on piety, because there is no specific text in religion that tells you that this is prohibited, for example. So Ziauddin Sardar helped me quite early through his writings to understand this, not ambivalence, as Zygmunt Bauman called it, but the ability to deal with different problems and seek solutions in different ways. And this is how I always saw comparative fiqh, you know, al-fiqh al-muqaran, to be ways of trying to use the methods of interpretation to see the different options that an actor, an agent has in dealing with the commandments and with the ahkam of the Sharia. This is a different understanding than, okay, what does God want from me and I should do it? And then dividing everything between halal and haram, which the fuqaha did not do actually in the first sense, and then turning that understanding into a way or a mode of thinking of the Muslim in dealing with the world and establishing new social sciences based on an a-modern understanding. 2004, I wrote a chapter in a book, and it was about trying to approach modernity not from a postmodern, but from an a-modern, as if we don't have to be pre-modern or primordial, and then we turn into modernity, and then we turn into postmodernist, and then we joined this whole facade of postmodernism and relativity and focusing on the self and the agents, and you know, we can actually step not aside history, but outside this mode of thinking and think in different ways. While we actually live within modernity, this is something that we cannot escape. But what we can escape is to think with the rationale of modernity, especially when we think about Islam. You know, and this is why one of my recent books was about the Islam, the political imagination of Islamists. Because quite early, again, maybe 16, 17 years ago, I started noticing and writing different articles and pieces, and pieces in journals and pieces in even magazines and newspapers and columns, etc., regarding how I noticed that the Islamists are very much obsessed with the state as the locus of politics. While actually the unfolding understanding that came from my side was that politics is, as a political theorist, that politics is not about the state, politics is about human nature and human bonds and communities. And then the theory of the state is introduced to tell us how to manage power relations based on that understanding of the human nature. Because if you assume that humans by nature are evil, then you really give credit to Hobbes. They are evil and they should be you know, under the authority and sovereignty of this sovereign, and there is no way to escape this social contract. But if people by nature and human nature is essentially good, then you walk on the path of Rousseau, for example. You know, when he said that human beings are by nature good, but they have to make the move and shift to become civilized from the, they shift from the state of nature to the state of civility, l'état civil, which was actually mistranslated into many Arabic debates by al-dawla al-madaniya. He didn't mean al-dawla al-madaniya, he meant al-hala al-madaniya. He meant the state, l'état, the condition in the terms of Hannah Arendt, the civil condition. And this civil condition necessitated, in his perspective, historically, political organization. So he's not very happy about it, but he says, this is what we have of options. And hence, how can we control the sovereign via the general will and via the different tools and institutions of representation, etc. But he's not happy. But what can we do? Alas, you know, as they say, and what can we do, as they say as well? So there is a complete difference between understanding this unfolding nature of the human condition and political structures, and starting with the political structure and trying to impose it on the human condition and say this is how you are going to regulate your life. And that's why I always tell my students political theory is about human nature, it's not about the theory of the state. It comes later. I was doing my PhD on the notion of citizenship, the concept of citizenship in Anglo-American liberal thought. And my specialty is called in German Begriffsgeschichte, it means the history of the notions. And you follow the meaning and the unfolding meaning, the keyword of this lecture is unfolding, unfolding meaning of terms and of concepts, and the semantic field and how it changes, and how it actually reaches a point where some scholars are very concerned. They say, if citizenship means so and so and so and so and so, and it has such multiple meaning, that it eventually has no meaning at all at the end. It has to have some boundaries. If you say, I'm the citizen of the world, nice, okay, fine. But how can then we build a bond, and how can this bond be manifested in codes of ethics and expectations from the other parties about your behavior, and then control if you go out of these expectations or go out of the social contract upon which it is based, and then how we are going to reward or punish, and how are we going to deal with the outer boundaries. And that's what made Carl Schmitt and others talk about, that part is about enemies and friends, where the line is drawn between an enemy and friend. Zygmunt Bauman, because he believed in ambivalence, he believed that there is an unfolding nature of matter and that there are so many options that we have in understanding and formulating what human condition and human nature is about and how to see the world. He said, no, there are enemies and there are friends and there are strangers. And he wrote a lot about refugees, and he wrote a lot about these nomads, the nomads and the nomadism that actually Deleuze in the French philosophy wrote about, that we are to depart from the modernist thinking, and the modern condition doesn't mean nomadism in Deleuze and Guattari's work, that we shouldn't necessarily move, but it's sort of a notion of feeling that you have more intellectual options, and that you can build, based on his relativist, at the end of the day, materialist perspective of the world, build your own metaphysics. You know, he called himself metaphysician, you know. But this is metaphysics within the visible, within the material world. It's not a metaphysics that goes beyond it. So this is also one of the things that we have this debate regarding, that this worldly view of modernity actually wanted to have metaphysics, but metaphysics made by man. Not the metaphysics that are transcendental, that we cannot basically test or develop or experiment with in the rationale of the pragmatists and Richard Rorty and others who wrote about that experimentation is what it's all about. And any attempt to go beyond this experimentation and to put some essential understanding of the world, even if it's philosophical, not only transcendental slash religious, then it's unaccepted. And it is a conversation stopper, as he wrote, and it will not be part of what he believes in. And I think that this debate within the different notions of modernity on the Western side, but also our own understanding of what our own modernity that we, or our own modern version, or understanding of our contemporary practice of Islam and understanding of the world and what we call people who join us in reflecting about, not to convert to necessarily, because this is the da'wah business, not the academic concern. It is basically this. This is what is what at stake. In all social sciences, there has been lately an understanding, and by lately I mean the last three decades. I mean, this is not yesterday. An understanding that we are facing a crisis. In social sciences, the whole field of sociology of religion since the late 70s, early 80s, and I can claim that not only because of the rise of the return of different people in different religious traditions to their own faith, but I can claim also that because of the Iranian revolution, to a great extent, we always undermine our impact on the world. We always see the impact of the world on us. But I think that the Iranian revolution was really something. That's what drove Habermas to write about it. That's what drove Foucault to write about it and to revise their understanding of religion again via the lens of the Iranian revolution. They found a different society, which is very much civilized as well with a long history, shifting, and nobody could expect. And the first question I ask my students in the classes of political theory, one of the first questions I ask is, why couldn't the American with all the super duper CIA, FBI, you know, institutions predict the Iranian revolution? Why couldn't they? And they always say they didn't have enough information. They say, it happened quickly. They say they were behind the revolution, you know, the conspiracy theory, whatever. And I say no, because those who were the political analysts and those who were working in the study and research unit in the CIA and the FBI and other institutions of, and the Ministry of Foreign Office and other places in Europe as well, were actually the students of the 60s. So by the late 70s, they were in these posts and in these positions. And what they learned in the 60s is the withering away of religion. So when they saw this man with the turban over his head and he's 80, living in Paris, calling his people to change their idea about wilayat al-faqih and about the revolution and calling them to resist, etc., they thought this isn't something coming out of the Middle Ages and this man is nuts. You know, he will never have any impact on the people. And they looked to the leftists and they studied the labor movements and you know. They couldn't imagine because they simply have something different, not in front of their eyes, unfolding actually that they could see, but in their heads. They couldn't see it, they didn't see it. And depending on what is in your head, the methodology you use as a student in studying phenomena, the look to the world that is very much imprisoned within the concepts that you study and you are taught to use as tools, to that degree, sometimes you don't see phenomena passing in front of you and unfolding and just don't see. You don't want to see them. This happens even on the individual level. When we hit a crisis and we realize that there were so many indicators in friendship, in marriage, in conflict, in a society, in a community, there were so many indicators because we simply didn't see them coming because we had a different understanding. This is what Edgar Morin, when he writes about anthropology of science and the method, when he writes, when he mentions that this exclusion of what was called then the mythical and the magical from the experimental and rational, this is what led to our crisis. He said we have to bring them back together. Of course, we will not call them any more mythical, or we will not call them any more superstition and what it was named and called in the Middle Ages or the coming out of the Middle Ages and looking at religion, but we will call them maybe transcendental, bringing the transcendental back in, as I wrote once a paper in the 90s. So at that very time, the political scientists were writing, bringing the state back in. And I wrote, bringing the transcendental back in when I was doing a research in London 1996. So thinking in an A-modern mode, or actually thinking in an Islamic mode, depending on where you are located. If you are not within the circles of Islamic audience, there is no point in addressing them with notions and concepts and terms they don't use and they don't understand. So it is not a trick, but it's better for them to understand, to make a communicative action, you know, that you use the words that they use and give it a different meanings, or go along their own argument, as we were taught by the Quran. قُلْ إِن كَانَ لِلرَّحْمَنِ وَلَدٌ فَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْعَابِدِينَ. If God has a son, I will be the first to worship. But he doesn't have a son, you know. So he goes along the argument, prove it to me, and I will follow. But I can't. If you now tell someone, don't think about it as a verse of the Quran, but someone is talking to others, and he will say to them, if God has a son, I will follow you, and he doesn't realize that it's a verse in the Quran, in terms of argumentation, he would say, what? You can't even say that it's haram. You can't even assume. You can't accept the assumption. No, you can accept, and okay, let's just try it. And this is the argumentation in the Quran. And it's very interesting, because I found that in the Quran, arguments don't stop even by the end of the world. They continue on the Day of Judgment. And people argue. And we are argumentative creatures. And even on the Day of Judgment, the person who is led to hell, he says, why? Why did you resurrect me blind? This is not fair, you know? And God said, because I showed you the light, and you insisted on being blind. And this is why you are resurrected blind. You know, God gave an answer. And actually, I was wondering, God shouldn't give an answer. You know, do anything about this, just ignore him, you know? It's like, but no, the argument was accepted. He was given the tongue and the language to speak and to argue. And God simply answered that his argument, and it's clear. On the Day of Judgment, when you don't have any will or a space or room for action anymore. And this is the way we should think. On my way to try to understand the world and make sense of it, not only because I'm a scholar, this is something that I don't think of myself as most of it. I think of myself as a human being. And I consider knowledge to be one of the tools or one of the ways I use in life to explore myself and to understand the world. So for me, it's a hobby rather than a profession. I enjoy reading and learning and sitting with students and having a circle of brainstorming. And on my path, I happen to go in different ways and then go back. So I would make like a short, it's not a shortcut, it's a long cut. So I would open a book, find a concept, because I'm obsessed with concepts, I follow the concepts, and then they lead me to something else. But because there is a circle of knowledge, and as Ibn Arabi said, the point and the circle around, you know? So I end up in this main square again, somehow, very magical. So when I was doing my work on citizenship in my PhD, I had to look into the city, because citizenship is not only a relation, which is always the definition, between the individual and the state, but this manifests itself in space and place. And this is where Heidegger was really very inspiring, the Dasein, the design, the being, the Da, the place, and time, when he talked about time as well. And interestingly, Sardar, when he talks about Sharia, he also talks about time. Time is a very essential concept in understanding anything in social sciences, which was actually freezed when we were thinking in terms of now and here. The secular sort of myth of let's just think about now and here and see what comes out of that, which actually Easton, in the study of political science, applied. And by the 50s, he started talking about the system analysis, etc. And he said, we have to invent new tools of understanding the world, and the old political theory does not help us much. We have to be here and now. And then he made the system analysis. And these systems basically collapsed. They collapsed after the Arab Spring in front of our eyes. We kept saying for about 2 and 3 decades that the nation state has a crisis, and nobody believed us. And they said, oh, you are the traditionalist, and you want to bring us back to the America and nonsense and blah, blah, blah. But then eventually it collapsed in front of our eyes in 5 years. In Yemen, in Iraq earlier, in Syria, in Libya. And yani, some of the other countries in the Arab region are yani, it's pending, loading, you know, it's still going on. And some states that call themselves states, they are actually based on our knowledge of politics, not states but tribes, basically. And there is no transparency regarding the treasury, there is no accountability in terms of politics. And these are not terms of liberal theory, these are actually essentially Islamic notions as well, you know, the accountability, the shura, etc. So the city was also one of the things I tried to look into. And the city brings us to the title of the lecture, which is the homo politicus. What happened across time is that the human being as a full entity has actually seen in all civilizations, in the Faraonic civilization that I come from, historically speaking, location-wise, and old civilizations, and Greek philosophy, is part and parcel of a city. And the city is an ideal in itself. We can then expand it to become the city-state and then the global citizenship. Or we can seek different manifestations of the city till we reach the cosmopolitanism and the globalization and the work of the sociologists when they write about the global city and the cosmopolitan. And the city here is a notion and an idea, but also a space. And this is very important. The literature recently that is dealing with the notion of the city has been actually in a crisis. Because the city, as we imagined it, as the basis for citizenship, is now, because of the inside, outside, and strangers, and nomadism, witnessing a fragmentation. A fragmentation that started actually with capitalism, that focused very much on the rationalism of the human being, not the communitarian affectionist dimension of the social coexistence, which the communitarians try to solve in liberal soap and to bring in the community and reintroduce it. But now, with globalization, the number of strangers sometimes is more than the number of citizens. And the example is Dubai, for example, which is seen by the ultra-modernists as the example of a city, which is very brand new, very technological. It's fascinating, but it is not the city as we know it. And I call it unprecedented in a way. Some people say Singapore is as well is one of those examples, where the creation of a capitalist hub actually overcame the understanding of the city as we know it in the political philosophy dimension. This is something that should bring us to understanding how the homo politicus, this human being as a political actor, as defined earlier, was actually fragmented, the meaning of fragmented. There is a distortion of meaning. We witnessed an over-obsession in modernity with law. There is a very nice book called Homo Juridicus. It's written by a French philosopher and legal writer. And he writes about that in the French legal tradition, the modern French legal tradition, the human being is seen as God. Something that Bertrand Russell said, that modernity basically replaced God with the state. So instead of God, we have the state, but there is that abstract notion of the individual, of the citizen, that is written down in laws, with no face, with no presence, with no distinction between different types of citizens, there's the social conditions, etc. Something that theories of multiculturalism try to address, but in some circumstances failed to do, because they focused on culture, not on human society and human community. They just wanted the facade of culture. And there were so many dilemmas and so many problems that emerged out of that notion of multicultural citizenship that are still being dealt with. And this is an option and a notion that actually the French Republican secular thought, contemporary one, refused to address. And if you go to France and talk to any philosopher or social scientist and say multiculturalism, they will say, no. Yani, we don't have this. I was in Paris once talking to the deputy of the mayor of Paris, regarding the notion of laicity, the notion of secularism. I had an opportunity to go as a visiting scholar for a week, and they ask you in that fellowship to choose one topic, and then they will take you to scholars, they will take you to practitioners, they will take you to decision makers, focusing on that notion that you are very, very, very concise and very focused visit. So for 1 week I was exploring the different meanings of laicity, of secularism. So I asked the lady, I said to her, when I was in, at that time there, there was a clash between young people in one of the banlieues, one of the outskirts of the neighborhoods in Paris, and there is one building, like it's like council buildings in Britain, you know, that it's given by the state, it's owned by the state, and one building there were Orthodox Eastern European Jews, majority, and the next building it seems there were Arab Moroccans or something. And the young people in the playground or in the area just had a fight, and one Jewish young man was beaten very badly. So this was an issue in the newspaper at the time, and what's going on, and the clash, and the fundamentalists, and the future of Islam came into the discussion as well, as usual in any such incident. And I asked her, I said to her, I heard about this, I was very, really very disturbed. But I wanted to ask you, because we're talking about the city and citizenship and secularism, I said to her, I know that in some Eastern European countries, there is a policy of habitat, a policy of housing, that makes it a condition not to have a group of one ethnicity, one religion, or one specific background, racial background, more than 40%. So that there is a distribution of the people who are living in a building along the different multiple ethnicities and religions that there are in the country, to be like a small example of the society. So children, when they grow up, they play with Buddhists, Muslims, Christians, and they come from they have different colors of skin, so they become tolerant and democratic, etc. And I'm aware of that policy. Someone making the presentation in my faculty earlier, and I was really interested in this building citizenship through housing policies. And I said to them, why don't you try this in Paris if you have this problem? And today there was that incident which is very sad, etc. And she said to me, but in order to do that, we have to ask the citizens about their faith, or to have documentation about their background. And this is against the secular ideal that we have. I said to her, okay, secularism is interesting and fine, I understand the background, etc., but it's obvious that you have a problem. And you have to face the problem, you have to see the problem, okay? It didn't work in some dimensions, and you have to find a solution. So, aren't you willing to negotiate the definition of secularism, laicity? I didn't say skip laicity. I said just negotiate the meaning and definition and to revisit the understanding. And she looked at me and she said, one word in French for those who know French. She said, jamais. Jamais means never. Jamais. And this is the issue. That when we live in cities, we don't have the courage to say that Istanbul now, for example, is transforming into a cosmopolis, and I am sad about that. I'm critical, I'm very critical. Because I think that we have to introduce in the policies of Turkey an understanding of the space and place that would enable us to invest and the economy to grow, but at the same time preserve the understanding of the scale of a unit of habitat that should not exceed a specific stretching in order for the human relations within it to be able to unfold in a healthy way. But also for Sharia to be able to be applied. Sharia is not about law. Sharia is also about community and morality. And ask someone who has 100 neighbor in a skyscraper or a very big building with 30 stories to be kind to his neighbors. Which neighbors should he be kind to? There is a cementation, cement coming from cement, you know, cementation of a different notion. A notion of being to yourself, of being in a small unit. The ultimate that you can do is to know the neighbor who is living next to you or in front of your home. That's it. But the notion of neighborhood, and being kind to your neighbor, and building on that, because it's not only moral and ethical, it's also sociological. Building on that, a social bond, and building on that, interestingly, in politics, the ability for a society to come together and resist authoritarianism and resist the dictatorship is actually fragmented. And this does not enable people in new neighborhoods actually to come together and discuss their problems. And also because of the cosmopolitan dimension, they are strangers. They don't know each other. And they come sometimes from completely different backgrounds. And sometimes 30-40% of them are not Turkish in the first place. They are Syrians, in our case in Istanbul. They come from other places, in some neighborhoods in Cairo. They are Iraqis, by the way. So many Iraqis went to Egypt after the decay of the state and the invasion of Iraq in 2003. And they actually located themselves in specific areas where they are the majority. The Syrians came also to Cairo. So we have some sort of similar problems. How can you then talk about notions of the homo politicus if you have all these fragmented backgrounds and the agencies do not share the same political notions of what authority is about, what are their rights, and what law and morality and community and policies should be like? And in some cases, they are not even allowed or invited to participate in the public discussion in the first place. This was interesting for me. What sort of homo politicus are we talking about? And if we see the homo juridicus and the homo politicus and the homo economicus and the different faces that different social sciences and fields of study that are divided and each one is trying to understand one face of, how can you bring this together? It's very difficult. And if it is going to be an ijtihad, if it's going to be an endeavor of trying to come up with new social sciences, then Emmanuel Wallerstein is reminding us that this will not happen if we continue to think the same way. And he has a very nice book titled Unthinking Social Science. You don't have to develop, you can't reform, because the essential assumptions are actually debatable. Wouldn't say it right or wrong, because this would be zero and one again, so debatable. You have to unthink this mode of thinking and go to the, how do you call it in the computer, the factory setting. Go back to the factory setting of fitra, factory setting, maybe not only walking in society and exploring phenomena with your mind, with your rationale, with your eyes, but also with your heart. And this brings the missing dimension. It's not only the transcendental that is beyond, but also the transcendental that is within. And here comes faith. And if people say, yes, but faith is something very specific and very personal. And you cannot, yes, special and specific and private. And also you cannot measure it, you know, because my faith might be different than yours, not better or worse, but different in composition, you know. So how can we bring faith? It will bring more conflict. But this is not what I mean by faith. I don't mean the settings. I mean the spirit. I mean the light. I mean that human beings should benefit and should find relevance between different fields of studies and other ones. There is a new, also emerging phenomenon that is really interesting. And I was struck by it. Not because I read about it, I started to read about it later and was really surprised by the huge literature on the matter from a different perspective, from a modernist perspective, which is the rise of the tribe. And 2011, after the 25th of January revolution, many people were busy doing politics. I was busy understanding politics. And I had the opportunity to actually visit many parts of Egypt. Egypt is so diverse, the north and the south, the east and the west. I was invited to many universities to meet the youth. There was this sense of, you know, almost euphoria about revolution and change, and we can change the world, etc. So I went to different places. And I discovered that everywhere I went, there were tribal social formations. Something I didn't know. I'm a middle class, urban, downtown Cairo, fishy person. You know, I have no origin, neither in the Upper Egypt areas nor in the Delta. My family is urban for the second generation. I'm the second generation urban. He was being flat homo citicus, not even politicus, I'm a city person. Okay, so I was struck by the bonds of the communities in the peasant areas, in the delta, in Upper Egypt, that we call Sa'id, and then I looked around with the scene in the Arab world, the rise of tribes in Libya, the rise of tribes in Iraq, the rise of Asha'ir and tribes in bands and tribes in Syria, the presence of tribes definitely in the Arab Peninsula, going even to the Moroccan Maghreb, you know, side, the western part of the Arab world and the northern Africa, Africa itself, Indonesia, Malaysia. What's this? You know, nobody taught us about that. We, as much as religion was assumed to be fading away, which didn't happen, the tribe was supposed to be dying, and people will turn into citizens. But actually, because the state did not fulfill the promises, neither in economic terms, social terms, cultural terms, efficiency terms, etc., people kept a foot in their tribal and authentic sort of affiliations based on lineage. And this brings us to Ibn Khaldun and Asabiyya. People used to laugh when we used to teach Ibn Khaldun 20 years ago and say, Ibn Khaldun, Asabiyya, and you know, and what is this? Why don't you teach Muhammad Abdu? Why don't you teach, you know, the modernists? Why don't you teach the national, the Arab nationalism, etc.? Why are you teaching these old writers, you know, Al-Ghazali? What should we learn from Al-Ghazali? Okay, if you don't want to learn from Al-Ghazali, Ihya Ulumuddin, welcome, learn from Al-Ghazali Al-Mustasfa. Learn from Al-Ghazali methodology of Usul al-Fiqh. Learn from Al-Ghazali Adab. Learn from Al-Ghazali many other things. I mean, we have Ibn Taymiyyah's Al-Fatawa, but we also have Ibn Taymiyyah of the Dar al-Ta'arud al-Aql wal-Naql, which is a fantastic book, you know, talking about reason and its relation to revelation and the unfolding different arguments about the relation between the two. If you don't like the fatwas of Ibn Taymiyyah, go to the methodology. What's wrong with that? If you don't like Ibn Khaldun as stories, history, it's a historical book, the introduction is an introduction to a historical long book. Okay, read the methodology in it, read how he read society, how he could understand that eventually Asabiyya is about the social bond. If there is an invented social bond, imagined communities as Benedict Christ, Anderson called it, then why don't we look into the duration of that is actually collapsing at the moment. The temporality of the notions of the modern bonds of relationships and citizenship and what we see now. Of course, sometimes your argument does not last for long in a discussion if people are not convinced, okay? Trump gave us a very good favor in this very much. I thank him very much for being elected the president of the United States. Because here again, we're talking about, actually not Trump is it, we're talking about what Huntington wrote 2004, when he asked and stated that Who Are We? Was the title of one of the books of Huntington, who was a great political scientist since the 50s, and should really, for those who are interested in political science, you should read Huntington. And he wrote and he said, well, guys, sorry to tell you, the United States is Anglo-Saxon Protestant, white. We're the one who built this from trash, from nothing, from, this was a no man's land. Okay, the American Indians were there, but yani, we will sort this out, this is history. But we were the ones who built the civilization, who built this American dream, and now there are Hispanics, and there are Afro-Americans, and there are different types of people, and we want them to know that they are equal citizens, but everybody should speak English. And he was not very much in favor of teaching other languages. And he stated and understood, he actually put the seed of Trump. Trump is the facade. The thought of Huntington in this 2004 published book actually led to the Trump, led to that, you know, sense of American nationalism, which is a contradiction in terms. Because we used to know that America is about the melting pot. And now they're talking about nationalism in America. So, what is this? Everything that we learned says that Trump did not come. Because we couldn't see. We ignored the indicators, of sociology of religion that talked about, since Bainbridge and Stark wrote in the 80s about the belts, the religious belt in America and its relation to voting trends. And we didn't see the unfolding changes in the policies. And we didn't believe. We always had two images of America, the liberal democratic and the nice sweet talk of Obama and others. And then we look into Bush and we look into Iraq and Syria and say, oh, why are Americans doing so? Why don't you just, you know, feel loyal to your liberal and democratic ideals, you know? But actually, Trump made us become disillusioned. Ku Klux Klan is coming back. Racism is coming back. Racism is coming back in France. They say Le Pen might win. Okay? Rising for a decade and more than a decade, there is a rise in the ultra-nationalist movements in Europe. Of course, the excuse is we have so many immigrants and we want to reclaim back our country, but this is not a good excuse. You know, so what are we seeing? The world is changing, and I think that never before have we felt the need to unthink social science. Because we are in a very embarrassing situation. People look at us. Max Weber said politics as vocation. So we are the specialists, we are the professionals, we are those who are working in this job of explaining to everybody everything. When I introduce myself, you're a political scientist. Okay, come, explain to what's going on in Syria. What is Erdogan doing? What is this Trump phenomenon? You know, explain. And I just sit there and say, well, I'm a mother of three children. We can talk about the children in such a world, and you know, and I'm Egyptian. We can talk about Egypt and the civilization, and because I don't have answers. Of course, I have some answers, but they are very much embedded in terms that lay people do not understand. So we are in an embarrassing situation. We could not predict anything. The American political scientists could not predict the Iranian revolution. Not a single Arab political scientist could predict the Arab Spring. We said that it's coming, but we couldn't predict that it would happen this way or it would happen within that time frame. And nobody could predict the return of the army in different countries, the return of the army and the surfacing of the brutal power of the army in Syria and in other places, including Egypt, for example. This strong fist under different excuses, you know, pulling the country together, nationalism, you are in a different situation in the Arab world, so we have to defend the state. This is not the issue. We have a phenomenon here coming back that is different from what we expected, because we actually and simply were not trained to deal with asymmetry. We are trained to deal with unilinear thinking. And this is what actually the theories of chaos and fuzzy logic and understanding of ambivalence and ambiguity and vagueness introduces to us. It's not that we are going to fall into an abyss of chaos, of ideas, but it's that it will provide us of a potential and the possibility to think again about many things and to bring together the different faces of the homo politicus to be met again based in a notion of humanism that is based on faith in our situation in the Muslim world. And this is not an easy task. I have been struggling to understand chaos theory. I come from a study of art, so I'm not very good in arithmetic and geometry and stuff like that. And computing, definitely no. I only use Word, not even anything else. Word and PDF. I'm very nice when someone comes to fix my computer. Java, I don't know what Java is. No, essentially no. You know, I only know words. Very simple. But words give meaning to the world. And this is very important. And this is why the study of language and understanding of notions and meaning and looking for the meaning of your own self with the capital S is very important. And I think that no single mind anymore can grasp all this knowledge. And we have to actually build groups. That's why I was suggesting this morning that we form groups of study, not of civilizations, because the line in my talk about my different research concerns and interests, etc., is not civilization in the very grand sense, in the large sense, but actually the line was civility. Human nature and civility, the city and civility, citizenship and civility, because we can have a city, and we can have citizenship in the legal sense, and we can have a civilization in the hegemonic sense, but without civility. Civility is embedded in the human self, and this human self has been divided and has been turned into its own self. And I think that it is important now to bring this unity back together, and this will not happen by one month. We need to build transdisciplinary and interdisciplinary groups of study to take different topics and think about them, and realize that without seeing what's going on, and then going back to your methodological toolbox, you will always see reality in terms of what you're supposed to see, as you will not see anything. And this is the worst thing that can happen to a social scientist.
This talk complemented that. It was kind of an extension of similar questions.
And actually, without interrupting, a good trend that we are witnessing now, I don't know whether it's going on in Turkey or not, but it's going on in Egypt and many Arab countries, that many people from the background of engineering and medicine are shifting to social sciences. Unfortunately, when they do so, they shift to social sciences and leave behind what they have been learning for sometimes 10 years. You know, I had a student at American University who had a master's, who was actually, he finished his master's in the faculty of medicine, and he was a faculty member. And then he was fascinated by the magic of political science, which is so chaotic. Why are you so happy about political science? Why are you coming to us, you know? And your world is much more orderly, you know, and he came. But unfortunately, he's very much interested in issues that he left medicine behind. And I told him, Muhammad, please, think about studying biopolitics. Because it brings together your understanding, your very good understanding of the human body, with our understanding of the body politic. And you would do great if you bring that knowledge to us. And he insisted on leaving everything behind. Engineers, my niece studied major physics, minor politics. And she wants to write about Turkey. I said to her, write about the chaos theory. You are a physicist, you know? And you studied minor politics, and you are interested in politics. Write about chaos theory, explain to us the nature of chaos theory. And most of those who are studying it in political science don't know, they're not very much powerful in the study of physics. And you bring both. And I even talked to Saba Mahmoud in Berkeley. I told her, and she said, send her, we can offer her a master's degree. And she's insisting on leaving physics behind and studying politics. So this is a dilemma.
So those who specialize in natural sciences and engineering, they realize that it is useless. They think social science is good, let's shift. So that we can find something there. And those who study social science, they come to conclusion it's useless. Then they have hope in the other side. But maybe science is totally useless. At the end of our life, come to this conclusion and then move to Hikmet, right, Rami? Yeah, Rami agrees with this. So maybe the best way is to adopt the multiplex epistemology and play at different levels at the same time, which is our tradition. This talk reminded me the concept of politics as the beer. One of our students, he's working on politics as the beer. So politics is called Tadbir al-Medina, governing the city. So it is very much like emphasizing the location, just like the citizenship, as
who is
Professor
Hiva.
You
should also consider Tadbir al-Ma'mura, going from the Medina to the Ma'mura to the globe. This is what Al-Farouq.
Yes, yes, so you can have a talk about that. I was fascinated by this, explanation that in the citizenship, so the loyalty is to the city, which is a place, in the traditional understanding. But in modern understanding, citizenship as understood as loyalty to the state. Which is like very transcendental, not linked with the space. And today, this is something which strikes my attention. Like modern people, they are not loyal, to the place where they are born, where they live. I observe this especially in America. In Turkey, still there is like loyalty, to the place that people come from, that they originate from, but loyalty always to the states, which is something very abstract. Like the state ends all other loyalties, tries to exterminate all other loyalties, and want people to loyal only to the state. So this is something very important, and we have this problem in Istanbul. People live in Istanbul maybe for five generations, and then you ask them where are you from, they tell you the city where their ancestors came from 100 years ago. Like, Rami, where are you from?
I'm from
Bitlis. So like people live in this city, but they never develop identity that they belong to Istanbul. Always they tell you where their ancestors came from.
You know the logic of the word Aslan is that it is about a volcanic imagination.
Yes.
Asluha thabitu wa faruha
hissan.
Ah. Wallahu anbatakum min al-ardi
hidayah.
It's a very brilliant word. That this is my root.
Yeah,
because if you are not rooted in any soil, then you eventually not be alive.
Yeah, there is a very interesting book about social memory. One French sociologist wrote it, So she talks about why it's so important for people psychologically to feel loyalty to a place.
Gaston Bachelard as well did that. Gaston Bachelard had the aesthetics of place. He wrote about the imagery of the home.
So it's very important for us to focus on this concept of civility, which is very much related to the civilization, but civilization is kind of broad concept. And now it's time for your comments, critique, contribution, and arguments. Yes?
So you mentioned that the Islamist political imagination was obsessed with the state. What was the reason for it? It was just a follow-up of classicalism perspective to politics, or was it something new under the impact of modernity?
I think so. My analysis was
so they were separated from the classical thinking.
Yeah, they couldn't unthink the modernity.
Mm-hmm.
They just says, okay, if this strong state is so powerful, why don't we use it to annul Sharia? And they didn't realize the Sharia has a moral and social infrastructure that is not there anymore in the city. Because the city is not anymore the city of the Prophet. It's not Al-Madina with Alif Lam Ta'if. When you say Al-Madina in Arabic, you mean the city of the Prophet. And when you say the city in Greek philosophy, you mean Athens. And This is the very embedded imaginary of the city in most civilizations. When you say, when you look into the imaginary of the city in the faith of the Muslim, it is Al-Madina. And if you say we want to bring back the community that used to be at the time of the Prophet in Al-Madina, you are not really understanding what it was all about. You neither understood the complexity of the formation of the society and the political community in Al-Madina, nor can you actually use it as a problem-solving methodology for your cosmopolis, because this needs a lot of work that has not been done. And then you fall in the abyss of just Islamizing what is modern. And this included the city. They didn't have any policies, the Islamists, I mean the Muslim Brothers and the groups, etc. They didn't have any policies, and they always said, we don't have a program because we're not in power. Don't ask me for a program. No, I would ask you for a program, not with the, with the, with the, with the figures and numbers for a budget, but I would ask you, how do you see the city? How do you see urban planning? How do you see the building the identity? How do you see the notions of identity? How do you, the multiplicity of it? What do you have? And they would say, my belief is Islam, and this is my cultural identity. Nice, but not sophisticated enough to be up to Islam itself as a risala li rahmatun lil alamin. So this gap was there all the time, and I think that I wrote the book actually in 2004 and then republished in 2015, because I found out that when my argument was published in 2004 and was written as a big chapter of a book that was published at the time, nobody gave it attention. But when we saw it happen in 2011-2013, and I was very critical about the performance of the Muslim Brothers, definitely not approving that they would be annihilated and be subject to the Holocaust basically that they are facing now. But actually they had an issue with modernity, and they had an issue with their own understanding of Islam. They just went to the state as it was. They thought that they can Islamize the Levite. And this is, and they didn't have options, they didn't have alternatives. Okay, we will not be able to do that, but this is going to be a phase, and then we will move phase two, phase three, phase four, without thinking that once they are in power, it will magically become Islamic because they are there, nor that they will impose on people a different type of understanding of faith, and then they will become a good society, a virtuous society. It doesn't work this way, you have to have a plan. And this, it was not there. Maybe, and this is what I assume, because they didn't have political and sociological scholars. I mean, those who, even with all respect, and this raises a lot of sensitivity from the Islam, even Said Qutb. Said Qutb was, his study was literature. And his writings about politics, his writing is about Tafsir al-Quran, great, and Muqawmat al-Tawr Islami, fantastic. Okay? But when it comes to politics, there are so many things that he doesn't understand. You know, and I can't depend on him, even if he was brilliant and genius, and he passed away in the 60s. You know, and I keep reading Ma'arif al-Tariq again and again and again, and when anything happens, as I said before in different lectures, you put a picture on your profile in Facebook. What does it mean? You know, it's running that to Said Qutb, it didn't help you. So the problem is that since the 60s, the Muslim Brothers did not have an intelligentsia, an ideologue, that would write texts, not one text, but more and more intellectual texts, because the mission is very big, you know. You claim to have the mission of Taziyat al-Alam. Fantastic, okay, nice. What is your plan then? How do you see the world? With which tools? It's not enough to simply state some verses of the Quran or Hadith, you know. This is not what I want, this is the base. This is the problem-solving methodology. Use it, and give me your ijtihad. And this was not actually the case. And hence, across 2 years, nothing was contributed, and this is not at all an excuse for the intervention of the army. But actually, we have to look beyond the victimization, you know, because the sense of victimization, to these 2 years, and study them very carefully. Because what was introduced was basically a very distorted form of neoliberalism. You know, so, and why? Not to condemn or to attack or to accuse, but to understand. What's the problem? Where was the problem? Where was the complex problem?
Yes,
Thank you very much. It was really fascinating talk. And it was kind of a journey for me because that was everything almost. First, there was a disorganized, very organized this other organ, kind of, like,
yeah.
It's really interesting. And
I
really
know when people sing a different tone in an orchestra and it comes out, but it doesn't come out
nice to my ears. No, I enjoyed it a lot. It was really thought-provoking. But I felt when you, the concept of unfolding, you bring us this idea that the world is, let's say, this uncertainty is embedded, and it unfolds all the time. It's totally kind of uncertainty when you bring up this Deleuze and this, you know, all the concepts with them. But at the same time, I hear this firm belief in certainty. Yeah, there are some certainties also in the world. How do you really bridge these two? And how this looks to be a kind of contradiction, but it seems it's not a contradiction.
Yeah.
Since this was a brainstorming, I just want you to follow your steps into this brainstorming. How do you bridge this certainty and uncertainty?
Yesterday I had a Quranic circle with the group I have on Facebook, and every week we take a concept in the Quran, the word in the Quran, and yesterday the word was the word of the word in the Quran, al-kalima, from al-kalima in the Quran, kalima, okay? And it's very striking that by the kalima, by the word of kun, be, the word was created. God created the word with a word, created the world with a word, and then the word became a message, and then the word became Jesus. وَكَلِمَةً أَبْقَاهَا إِلَّا مَرْيَمَ وَرُوحٍ مِّنْهُ. It was a word. It's described in the Quran that Jesus was a word given with the Spirit, you know. And then this was the miracle of Jesus. As a prophet, not as a son, but as a prophet. Okay? And then the word transformed and became the Quran. And this was the last message as we believe. So the letter is the absolute. This is the word of God. It's not the word of Muhammad. This is not the Bible. This is not the narration of apostles. But at the same time, because it's the word, it is unfolding in me. Unfolding in terms of your thinking about the meaning across time, till today, till the end of time, and unfolding in its manifestation, not embodiment, but manifestation in Sunnah. And then you can see that at the end of the day, in Sunnah itself, there was a lot of room for what Prophet Muhammad did not do. And we have a rule in Usul al-Fiqh that says, At-tarki laysa bihukm. Some people say, no, this is haram because Prophet Muhammad didn't do it. So the fuqaha, the scholars, made this rule. Not doing does not mean prohibition. Not because he did not do it, it's wrong or it's haram. He just didn't do it. And he didn't say, don't do it. So there is a huge room of unfolding realities according to which you can use the regulations and the principles and do the ijtihad with the word. And the word itself takes shape and meaning with a very strong backbone of language. That's why the study of the Arabic language is important. But at the same time, there is a spiral dimension of meaning itself in time. Around the same spiral center, but there is an unfolding meaning. And hence, yes, I have certainties, which are God, Deen, Quran, prophecy.
Can't go kill you.
Excuse me?
Can't the prophecy.
I like the man, but we didn't have a conversation face to face, so I couldn't convince him of my argument. You know? So, and otherwise, nobody has the right to claim that his understanding is ultimate. You have to study the tradition of fiqh, but build your understanding of fiqh as a problem-solving methodology, and this is what we can learn. I'm not a faqih, but I want the faqih to give me the tools to teach me over a year or two, the basic tools through which I can use some of them based on rationality, on logic, on understanding of the text, interpretation, specific qawaid and rules. And this is why I tried to, what I tried to do. I graduated in 87, and in 88 I went to a professor of Usul al-Fiqh methodology, Islamic methodology, and I studied with him a book of Usul al-Fiqh. I don't remember anything of the book at the moment, but it went into, it was sinking in my mind, and I was thinking after I finished. And it was done in a very traditional way. I used to sit on the ground and he's on a chair. I mean, very classic, you know? But something went into my understanding of the world and I could see it in a more 4D, you know, sort of 3D. It's not flat anymore. It opened a lot of windows. And we used to, I used to study not by him explaining, but he would say something and I would say, okay, this is what we call in politics and social sciences and sociology, so and so. So he would use the term. And I would say, and then he would say, because he's knowledgeable, he would say, no, no, this is actually so and so. And we used to compare notes of knowledge across disciplines. And this was the exercise. I don't claim that I learned it by heart, you know, but the exercise gave me some skills that I cannot put my hands on. And this is the engagement between the Sharia mind, the Sharia scholarship mind, and the social sciences that has been cut off. And if you now suggest to political science departments to introduce a basic course of introduction to Sharia, where we can teach Wael al-Hallaq was teaching in Cambridge, for example, and just to give us an idea about history of social sciences and history of the study of Sharia, that is the speciality of Wael al-Hallaq, nobody would give you that opportunity. For them, this is very irritating. And it is very much related to the turning of scholarship into an industry. You know when you want to publish a paper that there are restrictions, specific journals, there is a church. It's a church without any offense to churches. I mean, it's a church in hierarchical structure, it's a hierarchy. But actually knowledge is circular in our understanding. So I have to abide by the rule, talk about the topics that the journals are interested in, not go through the literature review and build on it. What if I want to unthink? What you would write would make them, people, very nervous because this is not what they know, this is not what they are used to, and this is not their tradition in teaching. It's you go into a temple. And this is why I have always dealt with academia as a hobby and with students as children, because I never felt comfortable in a structure like that. And I never felt comfortable in a structure like an Islamic organization.
Academia is your hobby, what's your job?
My job?
What's your vocation?
My vocation. My vocation is to be a human being. This is my vocation. Did I give you an answer that is satisfying?
Thank you. Yes, yes, Asma.
You getting really a relief because I have been dealing for months on the reading of postmodernism and multiculturalism. And that's almost a summary of my readings, but especially Bauman.
Sometimes you pity them, really. They are like, you know, when rats are put into this, how do you call it, this game with the different holes and the rats run inside, you know, in the maze, yeah? You feel like they are in the maze, you pity them, you know? It's like, why don't you go a bit more transcendent? And they want to bring the metaphysical in the physical. What a pity.
And just another question about Bauman. Actually, my thesis on the distorted relationship of postmodernism and multiculturalism.
Okay.
And when I read Bauman, especially he defines postmodernism as a level or as a phase of the as a conception. It's actually a clear society which is very rich and a consumer society. So, and after that, I just thought that maybe Bauman is not the right address to understand liquidity in multiculturalism. So, because it's like more complex, that's why I'm trying to unfold the relationship of how postmodernism couldn't address to the multicultural policies. And also, it's already approved the many terrorist attacks. But my question is, what should be the term in terms of liquidity? I was thinking, okay, we have many complexities, and we are like trying to escape from political science, sociology, but we can't because we're in academia, and it gives us. Very hard actually, especially in the thesis period. I mean, because we should like be in the box, but still we need to think about out of the box. That's the dilemma, especially in a critical thesis or in a critical study. So what should be the term? I was thinking that Sırat-ı Müstakim, not as a boundary, but as a, I don't know,
as a term.
As a freedom, give a freedom, because normally we think it like a certain thing. Okay, like don't go further, don't be less, don't be more. But I think this shouldn't be, since I don't have a very good Islamic studies background. But it should be a term that we can maybe apply, especially in a multicultural society. Just as I like understand how to manage the differences, how to manage the boundaries. And what do you think? What should be the term in terms of liquidity? Because I guess liquidity, this term doesn't correspond.
Yes, you understand.
What we are in multiculturalism.
Yes. Yes, please.
I think ta'aruf.
Ta'aruf?
Ta'aruf implies three levels in language. That's why Arabic is important. Language is very important. And that's why we believe that God chose Arabic to be the language of the last book. A ta'aruf is an interactive relation, a communicative relation.
Yes.
Okay? And ta'aruf is based on ma'arifa. So that it should be rooted in knowledge, not only in the communicative action. So it should be knowledge, and then communicating, transmitting that knowledge.
So this is also dialogical.
Exactly.
As Taylor says,
exactly. And then the third dimension of ta'aruf is of establishing habits. Habits of the heart, as the title of one of the books about communitarianism. And habits are معتبرون في الشريعة. Habits are part of the Islamic understanding of law. We have a different definition of law. Law is not the Western law. Our understanding of law entails morality, عرف, and the legal dimension of abiding by the rules. So the Shari'i notion of urf is very important, and you should look into it and its definition in fiqhi schools, different fiqhi schools, as a dalil. And then, of course, the mizan al-masalih, that you have in the diverse understandings of interests, and how we can make this balance between the different interests, what something that is called in Western theory, collective good. Collective good or the public good, not the public goods that we ended up with when we turned economy into a political perspective. Okay, so the public good, not the public goods in terms of public policy. Okay, there is a notion that should also investigate in relation to liquidity of Bauman that is rising, and that Bauman is very concerned, and he doesn't like the term and criticized it, which is hybridity. Okay? So try to see this sort of ambivalence. He wrote 1991. Bauman is very, I envy him actually. He writes like he breathes. You know, he writes, he has so many books. So it's important to see the line, the thread in his writings. So he wrote at the beginning of the 90s, after quite some time, despite what he's 90, he wrote about ambivalence and modernity. This book is very important to read. And then the liquidity, it can be summarized. Of course, he talked about liquidity in different dimensions of human life. So authority and surveillance. So he touches Agamben in liquid surveillance, for example. He touches the different social psychology issues of love and male, female, and human sexual relations, etc. But he wrote about hybridity as well. And he was very critical. He said hybridity brings us nowhere. It's like a melange without an outcome, without a taste. It's my words, not his, but this is what he actually described. So try to see him in more than just the liquidity dimension, because he didn't write only about liquidity. He was obsessed with liquidity at the end, but he wrote about ambivalence and about hybridity, and then tried to look into multiculturalism, this multitude, the notion of multitude, and then tried to unpack the very complex dimensions of ta'aruf. It's not a simple concept. It's a very complex concept.
Yes, ta'aruf is a multiplex concept. Yes.
I have like one question concerning the. I think some of the materials are considered very. One critical point which he raises in the remaking, in the rejuvenation of Islamic civilization in the coming years, the Arabs should play a sort of thought leaders. But I disagree partly somehow. I think that in the coming, if there is a sort of revival of Islamic civilization, the centripetal force would more likely be to be around in the Asia. So what would be
why not
Africa? Yeah, that's a good question. For one thing, okay. I think this issue is one of my
thoughts.
I'm in Ethiopia.
Okay. The Mauritanians are doing great job in preserving our Arabic tongue, by the way. Better, they speak Arabic better than Arabs. I mean, they are Arabs, of course, but I mean, better than the heartland of the Arabs, you know. So I agree with you. The periphery might be very important, and this is why I think to think about Arabism separated from geography. إنما العربية تلسان. And I think that Muslims should have the mission to learn Arabic. Because the whole point was that if the colonial powers and neo-colonial powers, what they are doing now is actually cut the relation between the Arabic of the Arabs and other nations, even the minorities in the Arab world. So they created a language for the Berber. They created a language written. They were oral languages. They turned them into written languages, the Berber, the Nubians, of course the Kurds have their own language, etc. So they want to turn the Arabs into like a small group and then hit badly, which explains all the mess in the Arab world, you know. And then others who don't have a good Arabic tongue, who learn it as a second language, Muslims I mean, would not know how to relate to the holy book. And then that's the end of Islam. And I think that, I don't think anymore of ethnicity and geography, though it's very important. But I think in terms of tongue, al-lisan, which is the description of the Quran, al-lisan in Arabic, he didn't say al-Arab. We are not a holy nation. We are not the sons of God. We are not sha'bullahi muhtar, the chosen people. We are not. And when Arabs thought they are the chosen people and dealt with non-Arabs ethnically as Mawali and Ajam and you know, the whole notion collapsed. You don't think this way.
Understood. My point was they like in one of his book, he talks about the idea of civilization being built by production of consumption. I see that nowadays the Arab world, generally speaking, is engaged in consumption, not producing.
Yeah.
So that production, I see that's what point in time being more. Stronger and vibrant in this Asia, like Turkey, for instance, Malaysia, that was not what it was.
No, I think that we should work more on making the study of Arabic easy through different tools and programs and software and self-learning tools, etc. It's very important because it's not impossible. I write and I lecture and I think in Arabic. I don't think in English. And I keep myself very much away from thinking English. But I can speak in English, I can write in English, I can lecture in English. And I don't think that what happened with me, between me and the English language, is difficult for someone coming from India to happen to him in terms of Arabic, or from Ethiopia, or from Malaysia, or from anywhere else. And I think that the mission number one for the Muslim world today is that it would learn Arabic, and it would have direct relation with the Quran, and then we will find a lot of production of knowledge.
Yes, thank you. So, who else? Yeah, I think we are loaded with so much, you know, new questions, and it will take you a week, I think, to digest this. Inshallah, will be another speaker next week on Wednesday, and I very much appreciate this talk, and it was a tour de force around many ideas and concepts in different disciplines. As a token of appreciation,
will be coming to our class. Sociology class, and she will be teaching English 10 years.
Ah.
2 weeks later. You can also come to our class.
2 weeks from now?
Or we will discuss. We will announce the date, but she will be attending one of our class for 3 hours.
Okay, so you can have the class here then. You can have the class. Alright, so this is our token of appreciation for you. Turkish coffee cups. In Egypt, they also drink Turkish coffee, which is not produced in Turkey. Come from somewhere else. Come from Turkey. Yes. So in Turkey, they have a saying that the memory of a cup of coffee lasts for 30 years. For which is a which is
very Cadunian.